that every day of your life, somehow, somewhere, you hear the music of Ludwig von Beethoven. His masterpieces reach out to all of us. Beethoven reached out to very few. His was a life of isolation. And yet it was out of that cauldron of personal despair that rose angelically such music. It is hard to understand it. It is hard to describe it without using the one word that applies to Beethoven as much as anyone ever born on this earth. Beethoven had genius.
Beethoven's music has electrified audiences for two centuries.
Genius is what possesses a man. Beethoven was possessed.
He's able to elevate us in a way nobody else can because he went through hell.
Beethoven struggled through hearing loss, abuse, and heartbreak. But the music kept playing in his head. His passion saved his life and changed music forever. Ludwig von Beethoven was born into a musical family in the sleepy town of Bonn, Germany, in 1770. Bonn was a quiet outpost with its famous, bold, and dynamic opening. Also in 1808, with his deafness closing in on him, 38-year-old Beethoven struggled to recapture the beauty of nature with his
my name's Tony Amore.
Pastoral symphony. He scrawled in the margins notes about how the symphony should sound like things he would soon never hear again, like bird songs and wind.
Beautiful.
He loved the feeling of earth, the sound of birds, the feeling of trees, the sunlight, making things grow. And he translated it in his own way, that if you just sit back and listen, it all becomes clear to you.
This is me in the Sentinel newspaper.
The Pastoral Symphony was also inspired by the beautiful Countess Josephina von Brunswick. Beethoven had been in love with as so many of his aristocratic women would do. She ended their relationship. She would later marry a nobleman.
He would seem to have the nerd's unfortunate propensity to be attracted to the capital of cheerleaders. Beethoven kept falling in love with long-leggy, blonde, married aristocratic ladies.
But Beethoven never gave up. In 1812, he fell hopelessly in love once again, writing heartrending letters to a woman he called simply his immortal beloved. The identity of Beethoven's immortal beloved would become one of the great romantic mysteries of all time. By 1809, Beethoven was 39 years old, and his deafness was advancing rapidly. Barely 10 years after his days as a star pianist on the European stage, he gave a series of disastrous recitals. They made him realize he had to quit playing because he couldn't hear himself anymore. So he turned to composing full time. He had to press his ears into the wood of his piano to create the lustrous Seventh Symphony in 1811.
Her friend Ludwig van Beethoven arranged a piano in the room. It's a fantasy scene, I'm sure. year in 1812, he wrote a heartbreakingly passionate letter to the woman he called simply his immortal beloved. Many scholars think it was meant for Anthony Brenton. Even when I am in bed, my thoughts rush to you, my immortal beloved. I must live altogether with you, or never see you. Perhaps the intimate revelation scared Beethoven, because he never sent the letter. But scholars and musicians have combed over its passionate prose ever since.
I sometimes read it again, like some stories of the Bible. If you read it from time to time, I think you are close to him. You understand that he didn't do anything without passion, without total commitment.
But, as always, Brentano, a mother of four, was way out of his social class, and their relationship ended.
It's a total conflict of emotion, and it never becomes resolved until such time as Beethoven, I think, gives up the idea of ever becoming a family man, of ever becoming a husband, of ever siring children.
But Brentano may not be the only candidate for immortal beloved. His former love interest, Countess Josefina von Brunswick, had a daughter about 9 months after the immortal beloved letter was written, and the child, who resembled Beethoven, was a musical prodigy. She may have been Beethoven's only child, and the product of what would be his last great love affair.
His lover, mistress, wife, with his music. There was no room for anyone else, and I suspect deep down he knew that.
Nearly 10 years since we made the film you're about to see, and it was a very unusual experience, because we went looking for this extraordinary character, Caravaggio, but we very soon found ourselves in a dark and alien world, combing police archives for witness statements from the painter's friends, his enemies, his lovers, meeting conspiracy theorists, each with his own story to tell. But through it all ran this sense that nearly 10 years since we made the film you're about to see, and it was a very unusual experience, because we went looking for this extraordinary character, Caravaggio, but we very soon found ourselves in a dark and alien world, combing police archives for witness statements from the painter's friends, his enemies, his lovers, meeting conspiracy theorists, each with his own story to tell. But through it all ran this sense that what we were experiencing was very much history in the raw. I was completely hooked.
This is the story of the life and death of one of the greatest painters who ever lived, Michelangelo Merisi, also known as Caravaggio. In a wood behind a beach on the coast of Tuscany, there's a monument to his memory, close to where he's said to have died. But it doesn't mark a grave, and there are now those who say if it marks anything, it's a cover-up to a murder. Caravaggio was a painter who changed the way we look at the world. He lived in violent times and made many enemies. But who could have wanted him dead? That's what I was here to find out. Story goes that in July 1610, at the age of just 39, the great painter Caravaggio succumbed to heatstroke and exhaustion somewhere on this beach. It was the end of a truly extraordinary life. Caravaggio wasn't just the most famous artist of his time. He was also a convicted killer. He'd murdered a man in Rome 6 years earlier, been sentenced to death, and he'd been on the run from the law ever since. The court... Story goes that in July 1610, at the age of just 39, the great painter Caravaggio succumbed to heatstroke and exhaustion somewhere on this beach. It was the end of a truly extraordinary life. Caravaggio wasn't just the most famous artist of his time. He was also a convicted killer. He'd murdered a man in Rome 6 years earlier, been sentenced to death, and he'd been on the run from the law ever since. In the course of his adventures, he'd dueled, scrapped, and hoarded with the best of them. He'd been accused of sodomy. He'd somehow managed to escape an attack on his life by a group of armed men. All this while creating some of the most profoundly moving spiritual paintings in the history of Western art. But what I want to know is, where's the body? The fact that there's no record of his burial is odd in an age when receiving the last rites meant the difference between heaven and hell. People, especially great artists, didn't just disappear in early 17th century Italy, but Caravaggio did. Early accounts say he died here at Porto Ercole, that he was on his way to Rome from Naples to receive a pardon for the murder he'd committed. But he got separated from the boat carrying his possessions, including several paintings, and in a panic, chased after it on foot. The most puzzling thing about this story is the geography. Caravaggio was going north from Naples to Rome, so how on earth did he end up coming here, 200 kilometers further north, to Porto Ercole? If Caravaggio hadn't been a genius, there'd be no reason to care. But I wonder if the riddle of his death might hold a key to the mystery of his work. He's an enigma, all right. Look at him in his first self-portrait, as Bacchus, god of wine. But this Bacchus is sick, the grey-green lips echoing the bloom on the grapes he holds. Who's the man behind this teasing disguise? Caravaggio painted with light. His realism has a strange, haunting quality, as if everything tells a story. But the artist's own part in that story is open to interpretation. To some, he's a homosexual revolutionary. To others, he's a profoundly misunderstood religious artist. Some see these peaches as Christian symbols. To others, they're ripe with sexual suggestion. Or maybe they're just peaches.
At booking.com, you can find a house, a car, and even a bubble.
But what happens there, that finds you.
Sicily, the largest island in the Mediterranean, is the most diverse region in Italy. A land of gods and natural forces, and a place of ancient cultures. A picture of tranquility and silence. The Madonie Mountains are known as the Sicilian Alps. The Pizzo Carbonara is the island's second largest mountain. This 77,000 hectare area has been protected since 1989 to the benefit of both nature and the people who come here. The road leads to further mountain villages. Many of them were created by the Romans. The Arabs, the Normans, enlarged them for the security of the inland area. Throughout the centuries, the simple villages of this region have gradually helped to form this landscape by way of agriculture, farming, and cattle breeding. Nature has always been a part of life here. Yet in spite of the harshest conditions, man has always found a way of cohabiting with nature. Due to the splendor of a truly golden epoch, the city of Agrigento is one of the most well-known and most visited places in Sicily. Cathedral is situated at the highest point of the city's medieval district. It can be seen from far and wide, and throughout the centuries has gradually been developed. Under King Roger II, trade with Africa flourished. But when later the Arabs were driven away, the city's economy suffered. The nearby 13th century Cistercian monastery is one of the oldest and most beautiful religious.
Phones are good, because new pay as you go on 3 comes with benefits, winky face. Calls, text, and data, plus a free subscription every month on us. Find your focus with Headspace. Then find your Tinderella on Tinder. Aww. Happily ever, never. Bye. Then respawn on Xbox, Game Pass. Then keep up with reality TV on Hey You. Then get a Korma Deliveroo to you.
C'è un destecco fondo in metallic, no?
Yeah.
Good song. I love this song. Hallelujah,
hallelujah. Your faith was strong, but you needed proof. You saw her bathing on the roof, her beauty and the moonlight overthrew you. She tied you.
Other kids are outside playing and having fun, and for me the fun thing was sitting in front of the piano, which is kind of odd at that age.
So other people knew straight away that you had this incredible talent?
Yeah, I was just trying to be good, you know, play the things that my teacher told me to play, and then it seems like they're always impressed in the concerts, or like, oh, this little prodigy. But for me it was just playing the piece I taught to play.
So where do you find inspiration?
I get lots of inspiration from reading books and watching movies and shopping and just basically enjoying life, because now because of playing, it's taking me to lots of places I never thought I was going to travel to.
And is it different when you're going to go home with the LSO? Is
yeah.
that you know, but your face just lit up then. Will it be lovely to perform for Chinese and big Chinese concert halls?
Yeah, it's my hometown, and they do have lots of lovely concert halls building up every week. I love playing with LSO, and it's great to go there for 10 days. And my family is in Beijing, and we're going to Hong Kong and other places.
So how are you received when you go home to China?
They're very enthusiastic. Yeah, and I feel this warmth towards me because I'm Chinese, you know.
How are you seen at home in China? How are you perceived? How are you seen? Are you a superstar there?
Probably. I don't know.
Is the audience growing for classical music in China?
Yeah, it's growing, and they're very civilized now. No cell phones. And they really listen. And lots of people who are fanatics for classical music, they really follow every detail, which is kind of scary for artists. But in a way, it's good. It's like you're playing for someone who really knows what they're going.
For me, it has not been especially difficult. I would not use this word. What is difficult is to stay now in this condition and to keep the challenge. For me, it has not been especially difficult. I would not use this word. What is difficult is to stay now in this condition and to keep the challenge up. that is very difficult. And how I become, I don't know how I became. I just follow the way. And the most important thing is my meeting with my coach, Rena Cherchevskaya, my great teacher that is living in France, but it is Russian. And yes, she was the first person to get me in touch with the requirements of the interpretation of the piano. And I discovered this whole part I ignored absolutely before, because before I played a bit, I played for myself, I played absolutely wildly. I had no difficulties to memorize, to learn some pieces, but I didn't do it seriously, very with all the details. For the first moment, I can get a whole piece in mind, like something like approaching the piece, I just throw the score away and just play for myself. So it was not a serious work. And she was the first to put myself in that direction and make me feel the necessity of that. The necessity of the respect for the music. It's not even the respect for the composer. I'm not specially interested. I said it already, but I'm not specially interested by the question of style. For me, it has not to do specially with the style. The style of who can really talk about the style of Mozart? Nobody knows Mozart. So the only clues we have are in the score. So it's not even a question of Mozart, it's the question of the score. What we have with the score and your ears. The contact between the score and your ears. And all the work is that. So talking about style and fingers, it's absolutely not my thing. You know, training with the fingers and just thinking at the last moment about the style. Oh, I have to play French music, so it has to be light, and I have to play Beethoven, so it has to be... It's ridiculous for me. Because it's only creations of, I don't know, critics or people who are creating who want to make some kind of confrontation between the composers. But all composers are friends in that sense that they all give their life, devote their life.
It's my friend's music. Phil Dooley goes to the American Clubhouse in Stoke-on-Trent, Staffordshire. Used to go to the American Clubhouse. He's written this music himself, he's composed this music himself, and he's playing the electronic guitar and synthesizer. He's got a Higher National Diploma in music, Phil Dooley. And he's from Stoke-on-Trent, England. He's a good friend of mine. And he's composed this music, Lake of Winds. It's a privilege and honour to know this guy. He goes to the American Clubhouse and in Basel, Stoke-on-Trent, which is for people with mental health issues. A lot of talented, creative people go there. Paul Warlow, we've mentioned before, he goes there. Obviously Phil Dooley and Ray Finney used to go there. And Pete Liner, and I also. Got the American Clubhouse. He bears some stuff on Trent, Staffordshire. Paul Dooley's music. Guy, very talented guy, Phil Dooley. To compose this music is wonderful. Thank you.
artist here. This is some work I've done. This is Raphael. And Raphael died at the age of 37. He's an amazing artist. And this is another Raphael as well, working on here. This is a Sistine Madonna. This one's like an allegory of love, which I've done here. Love Raphael. He's an amazing artist. Born in 1483, died in 1520. All I like about his work is his figures, how beautiful they are, how titanic they are, majestic, exquisite figures that he did, beautiful colouring, very bright colouring. Doing this slightly during my life, it's a beautiful gift that God has given me in my hands. This is what I like. That's what I like to do. So I draw in biro pen first, then I colour it in. Like the masters,
I don't draw in biro pen anymore. I used to.
Michelangelo, Leonardo da Vinci. And use a light colours first at the base, and then darken the colours. That's what I do. Here I buy some graffiti though. So Stoke it says.
Oh,
so, there's an S, there's a T, O, K, D. Hang on with the allegory of love with that. It's Amorini, baby Cupids. Una amore a prima vista. Love at first sight. Angelo Divino. This one is.
so amazing this is. This album. Pink Floyd.
Easter, Cadbury are adding a sprinkle of magic by bringing you Cadbury's Easter Egg Hunt.
Thank you.
happens when you connect people and possibilities? Innovation soars. Communities flourish. People prosper. Discover what's possible.
AJ Value Invest helps people invest online. Whether you're a toe dipper, a number cruncher, or a savvy saver ready to jump right in, we've got investment ideas for you. For low-cost SIPs and ISAs, discover your inner investor at youinvest.co.uk. AJ Value Invest does not provide advice. Capital at risk. Tax rules apply.
This is where I own myself. I own myself from there. What I did is I put a bag over my head, I tied it here, and then just swung for about, I don't know, 10 seconds. Then I dropped. That must have been. This is where I own myself. When I own myself. I own myself from there. What I did is I put a bag over my head and like that. Just thinking about it right now. Because that's quite a drop, isn't it, there?
You're never going to try anything like this again, are you?
Well, I can't say that, really. Because if I said no, I'd be lying.
In the UK today, 10 million people have some form of mental health problem. Depression, schizophrenia, anxiety, anorexia, self-harming, paranoia. They can affect anyone and every one of us. It's a mad world.
So this is my living room. Hola, living room.
Tony Amore is an artist living alone in Stoke-on-Trent. His mental illness takes the form of severe mood swings and paranoia.
This is my life. This is my life. This is what I'm like. Very complex person.
Why's your washing machine stuck in the middle of the floor?
Why? Well, why is it stuck in the middle of the floor? That's a good question. I took it out. Somebody, myself, took it out to fix it up. And now it won't go back in. So it's been like that for about 6 years, how long I've lived here. So I haven't got a recent one of my mum, but this is my mum. It's not recent, as you can tell. So that's my mum. The fact that there's five boys and my mum is ill, my granddad's just died, you know, that's a little bit thingy. That's all my immediate family. My immediate family. Four brothers and my mum. You know, all ill.
Tony's mum lives in a care home 2 miles away.
I haven't spoken to her for ages, like, for about 6 months. And I've had a lot of problems. I don't fancy going up and telling her how ill I am and seeing how ill they are and all the other problems that I've had with debts and things, so...
you hate wearing glasses, don't skip this video. Having to wear glasses or contacts day in and day out can be extremely frustrating. But now, each year, millions of people choose to get laser on.
Thank you.